Yes. That media is a sordid affair. Hey, it's... There's something going on with my headphones here. Hold on. How's that? Is that better? Am I coming through? Loud and clear? Check. 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 Test. Check. Check. Peter Piper. Okay. Hey, you're listening to WFMU East Orange, WXHD Mount Hope Worldwide. On the World Wide Web at WFMU.org. This is the best show on WFMU. My name is Tom Scharpling here with you. Until 11, we've got a fun-packed show tonight, including our special guest who will be up in an hour, Paul Collins, the author of the book Banvard's Folly, which is subtitled, for those of you who need subtitles. 13 Tales of Renowned Obscurity, Famous Anonymity, and Rotten Luck. A really good book. So we will be talking to Paul Collins later in the show. But in the meantime, let's hear some music from the band that we had up here last week. Actually, the guy from the band we had up here last week. That's right. We did appreciate Mick Jagger coming by. Here's something from Satanic Majesty's request, the Rolling Stones.
My name is a number of Tell me what's your name. I wanna know why you're following me. They try to deny what I can see. I've got eyes in the back of my head. Oh yeah. Darkness I could see so clear. Know when someone's getting too near.
Hey, everybody. Before we get too involved here, let me just Let me just do that. Now we can get started. Hey, yeah. You're listening to the best show on WFMU. My name's Tom Scharpling, here with you until 11 each and every Tuesday night. Except for the last three. Because there was 1 week I was not well. And then the following week was Christmas Day. And the week after that was New Year's Day. So I was unable to do my show for those 2 days. But now I'm back. And now we just go full steam ahead. The show is just back on course right now. We don't look back from this point on. It's 2002. And hey, later in the program, I believe at the 9 p.m. Hour, you can look forward to the author Paul Collins. He'll be calling in and talking about his fantastic book, Banvard's Folly, and it really is a great book. Subtitled 13 Tales of Renowned Obscurity, Famous Anonymity, and Rotten Luck. Very interesting stuff. We'll talk to him all about it during the 9 o'clock hour, but in the meantime, the phone number, 201-200-9368. The email address, toms@wfmu.org. And you know what I want to talk to right now? Anyone who received their FOT card in the mail, their Friends of Tom card. They went out this a few days ago. People who wrote in to join Friends of Tom, which is the, for lack of a better term, fan club associated with the program. All you need to do is email toms@wfmu.org. And you will receive a fantastic Friends of Tom membership card in the mail. They went out. They should have hit people's houses yesterday. If you got yours, call 201-200-9368 and tell me all about it. Or, if you want one, again, toms@wfmu.org. That's all you got to do. It's so easy, it's not funny. So, hey, we just heard the Bevis Frond from the album Inner Marshland. I've got eyes in the back of my head. Great stuff. I believe this was recently reissued. So you can pick that up at your local record shop. Ah, the Groundhogs before that from their album Split. Also reissued, I believe, about a year or so ago. We heard Cherry Red. Good stuff, the Groundhogs from the year 19. That's right, the year 19. So this record is almost 2,000 years old. No, actually, it's the year 1970. The Spiny Anteater, something new from their album, Well Laid Plans. We Kicked Back. The Spiny Anteaters, as everyone knows, a band from the, oh, wow. I'm looking at the booklet here, and it's a comic book with not one shred of information in it. So, you know what? I shan't tell you where they're from, because I don't know. I'm sure you could visit their website and find out more about them. So check out thebabyuniverse.com. And starting off, the Rolling Stones from the album Her Satanic Majesty's Request. Their Satanic Majesty's Request. Excuse me. Please, I don't want any letters about that slip-up. I'm not an android. I am not David from AI. Even he would make that mistake. Then again, I think he likes... What was that horror? Was it Nine Inch Nails were in AI? Was that it? Who knows? Who cares? We heard 2000 Man from the hit album Their Satanic Majesty's Request. Recently reissued on the Sub Pop label with bonus tracks, actually reinterpretations of the album Their Satanic Majesty's Request by artists such as Tad, Swallow, and Catbutt. So that's exciting, and look for that at the same record shop that sells records by the Spiny Anteaters, Groundhogs, and the Beavis Frond. Hey, once again, the phone number, 201-200-9368. The email address, thomas@wfmu.org. Call in now. I want to hear from someone who received their Friends of Tom membership card in the mail. Holy moly, what's up here? What's on tonight? Is something good on TV? That 80s show, is that on tonight? That 80s show, are we up against that? Oh, I hope not. Otherwise, it's going to be like this every week. Forever, because that show will run forever. That show just looks horrifying, doesn't it? I like how there's a girl in that 80s show with this huge kind of spiked hair that's like 3 feet high, and it's like, that's not the 80s. What? Where in the 80s is that? WFMU, you're on the air.
Hello, Tom.
Hello.
I have a thought card.
You got it? What's your name?
Eric Walker.
That's right.
Yeah, and it's really nice. Nice and sticky.
Oh, thanks.
Yes. Must put a lot of time into them.
You walking a little taller today with that card?
I definitely am. Gonna put that right in the wallet. Carry that around.
That's right. Put it in the wallet, and you know it will get you out of trouble, that card.
Out of trouble, huh?
Yes.
I show it to a cop, and he'll let me off?
Well, not a cop. It will get you just... It will keep you out of trouble more. It's like a... it's like a leprechaun. Like a kindly leprechaun that will guide you... When you're on the edge of maybe doing something that's not good, it will talk you out of it. Although I can't guarantee that it will do that. Don't count on it to do that.
That's pretty crazy.
Yeah,
that a card can do that. Yeah. You know.
So hey, what did Santa Claus bring you?
I know what Santa Claus didn't bring me.
What's that?
You at the Amboy Cineplex.
No, you weren't there.
You big liar!
That's why I wanted to talk to you guys. Oh, thank God you brought this up.
You are a liar.
On Christmas Day, I show up.
We were standing there. You are lying.
Oh, you're a liar.
You are a liar.
Oh, you are. Let me talk first of all.
All right. I'm sorry, Tom.
Christmas morning, we had scheduled a fight.
10 o'clock.
Between the Hasu kid and the anti-Hasu kid, Eric, and the two of them were going to.
It's really Brandon. He's the main.
The two of them were going to square off and fight at Amboy Multiplex at, I believe, 11 a.m.
You said 10.
Okay, was it 10? Well, I showed up at 9 to get the fight ready.
I'll tell you the truth, Tom.
Yeah?
We didn't show up.
I know you didn't.
You didn't show up either.
Yes, I did. Oh,
you know why?
Why?
We had a problem getting there.
Yeah?
So we wanted to reschedule it, actually.
Uh-huh.
But since you didn't do the show for like a month.
Yeah, a month.
I couldn't tell you.
Yeah, only 3 weeks.
Oh, three
That's
weeks.
1 week short of a month,
I'm sorry.
My friend.
I thought it was four.
Oh, I'm sorry. I was sick that one week.
I called you, and I was under a table. It was great.
You didn't show up for the fight. That's all I'll say. So therefore, I'm going to need you to send that FOD card back, and I'm going to strip you of your ranking.
You can't take my FOD
card
away.
No, I won't. I won't take your Friends of Tom card away. All right? But thanks for calling, young man.
Oh, no problem.
All right, you have a splendid evening.
You do too.
Oh, thanks.
All right, bye.
WFMU, you're on the air.
Tom.
Yeah.
Hi.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you?
All right. Who is this?
This is Doug from Buffalo.
Hey, Doug. How are you?
I'm doing wonderfully.
Oh, that's good. How are things in Buffalo? Snowy?
Yeah.
Were you part of that whole snow thing going on up there?
I was involved, reluctantly.
Did you get buried alive? Like, literally, you looked at your front door and it was just
Actually,
stacked?
I was in Michigan at the time.
So you couldn't get home?
The horrible thing occurred. You know, I could get home.
Mm-hmm.
Until I reached the city line of Buffalo.
Uh-huh.
And then it was total chaos and cars were spinning and, you know, I don't know.
Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm well, thank you.
Is everyone all right? Did you know?
Everyone seems to be fine.
Is Buffalo, was the city dug out now? Is it?
Hardly. Tom, Buffalo, the city doesn't own any plows for some reason.
Really? So they never looked into that?
It's the snowiest city in the world.
Uh-huh. But they don't own actual snow plows.
They don't seem to, no.
They don't seem to?
No.
Sounds like something for the town hall meeting.
I think so.
You might want to bring that up.
If I end up going.
Yeah. If you can get back into the... Now, are you still on the outskirts of Buffalo?
No, I'm right in the heart of Buffalo right now.
You made it back.
I did.
Now, you didn't happen to get your card in the mail, did you?
Actually, I did, Tom, and I wanted to thank you.
Oh, you're welcome.
Very much.
Have you been just staring at it all day?
Well, since I got home from work,
uh-huh.
It has been on my coffee table.
It was like a gift, right? Like a
Yeah, I wanted to tell you the feeling I got when I picked it up.
Was it like biting into a York peppermint patty?
I was actually going to say it gave me a warm feeling. More of a warm feeling.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Oh, that's not bad.
No, it was nice. It was really nice.
Well,
I'm still kind of warm, actually.
Well, I appreciate you you writing for the card and... Everyone else can do it. How did you do it? Just tell
them. I wrote
you
an email, Tom.
That's right, and then you got a card sent a couple weeks later.
That's right.
Fantastic.
Well, thanks.
Well, Doug, I appreciate you calling.
I did my best, Tom.
Well, you did your best, but I guess your best wasn't good enough. What song is that? Do you know what song that is?
No.
I gave my best, but I guess my best wasn't good enough.
Right?
That's actually not it.
That's
no, that is it.
That's a different
one.
Who?
What song is that, though?
I have no idea, man.
That's, is that On the Wings of Love?
I think it might be.
Okay.
I wouldn't have guessed on my own. Mm-hmm.
Hey, does your wife still hate the show?
That was the other guy from Buffalo.
Oh, that was the other guy from
Don.
Buffalo. That was Don, okay.
Yeah. No, my girlfriend loves the show, actually.
Okay. All right. Well, I appreciate you calling, Doug.
Thanks a lot, Tom.
All right. You have a good night.
Love the show.
Oh, thanks.
Take care.
Hot phones. WFMU, you're on the air.
Hey, is this Tom?
Yes, it is.
Tom, it's Stan Roberts from the We Love You Jesse organization down here in Raleigh.
Oh, hey, how you doing?
I'm doing good. Hey, we're putting together a gala goodbye TV special for Senator Helms.
Uh-huh.
This February.
Okay.
And I'm calling about procuring your services.
My services? Well, you know, to tell you the truth, this is for Jesse Helms, the senator?
Well, yeah.
Yeah, I kind of would not be interested in that then, because I'm not a big fan of him or his views or his politics at all.
Senator Helms is a big fan of yours.
He's a fan of this show?
He loves the show.
I find that very hard to believe.
Well, it's true. He heard it from his good friend Maurice Kern at Citizens for a True Democracy.
Okay, well, that's somebody I did have on, yeah. Well, I guess that's flattering.
Well, listen.
Uh-huh.
We got tons of great celebrities and sports figures on board already.
Okay.
We got Rue McClanahan.
All right.
Robbie Knievel.
Uh-huh.
Delta Burke.
Okay.
Pat Morita.
Okay.
Philadelphia Philly Greg Luzinski.
Uh-huh, the Bull.
the refrigerator Perry.
Yeah, his Chicago Bears. Wow, this is...
Here's a real coup, though.
Uh-huh.
Are you sitting down?
Yes, I am.
Ronald McDonald.
You mean the burger spokesman?
Yeah, and not only him, but other hilarious McDonald Land characters.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. So you guys actually put together pretty much
like I said, it's a gala event.
This is like a 4-star production.
It is.
Wow.
Well, Tom, here's where you come in.
Okay.
There's also going to be a Jesse Rocks concert, rock and roll concert.
Uh-huh. For Jesse, for the senator.
Yes. Yes.
Who I don't picture as being the most rockin' guy.
Oh, well, you know, he's heard of it. He's heard of it.
Yeah, I kind of... he's heard of rock and roll.
Oh, well, sure. I mean,
oh, wow. So you mean in the 60 years he's heard about it.
He likes... He's a champion of the arts, as I'm sure you know.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So here's where you come in.
Uh-huh.
Okay? We want you to be the MC of the show. And before you say anything... Listen to this lineup, okay?
Okay. Ready? Yeah, I'm ready.
We got Roger Thorpe of 38 Special, Steve Morton of Molly Hatchet, Paul Dinkins of the Charlie Daniels Band, and they've formed a super group just for this show. You know what they're called?
What's that?
It's hilarious. The Dead Osamas.
Wow, that is hilarious.
Isn't that great?
Yeah. Who wrote that one?
What do you mean?
Who did that? Paul Dinkins?
Roger, Steve, and Paul. Yeah, they put the band together, and it's going to be great. They're going to do hits from all their bands. They're going to do Flirting with Disaster, Caught Up in You, The Devil.
Wow. Well, that sounds horrifying
there's
on some
more.
Level. Yeah? Oh, wow.
Here's the big news.
Okay.
Actually, this is part one of the big news. John Stamos is going to reform his old band from the early 80s called the Bad Boys. And get this.
Uh-huh.
Robbie Knievel is going to do a drum battle with John.
Wow.
And the winner gets to light fire to a map of Afghanistan.
Wow. Oh, so that's a... Wow, what an honor.
Oh, it's going to be great.
So this is just... I can see how this is right in line. Jesse Helms will just be... he'll be bowled over to see this celebration. This is like, he should be pleased as punch with this.
Oh, he's going to love it. He's going to love it.
Yeah. It's in line with him, too, with his...
Listen, on a logistical note, I wanted to run this by, okay?
Uh-huh. Okay, I can tell you, you might want to save your breath, though, because I'm kind of not...
Hear me out, okay?
Okay.
We're going to shoot for 7 days in the Bahamas. 5-star hotels, all meals comped.
Mm-hmm.
You'll also get a $200 per day per diem.
Okay.
Now, I got to tell you, there's not a ton of money in this for you.
Uh-huh.
I'm sorry to say, okay? We can only do 10 a day.
$10 a day?
No, $10,000 a day. Oh, you want more? Okay, how about 15 a day, 15,000?
For 7 days?
Yeah.
15 grand a day?
Yes.
And in the Bahamas?
In the Bahamas for 7 days. You will not have to pay anything, and you'll obviously reap the financial benefits.
And I'm just emceeing this thing.
Pardon me?
All I have to do is come and emcee?
You are only going to emcee that stuff, yeah, the rock and roll part.
Huh. Wow. You know, you kind of piqued my interest here, I gotta say.
Are you going to do it?
For 15 grand a day?
15 grand times 7.
Uh-huh.
Plus 200 a day, 200 bucks a day times 7.
Mm-hmm. I would do this. I think I will do this.
Well, great. Hey, well, get those swim trunks ready, okay?
Uh-huh.
You're going to have a blast. And I did want to tell you this before you said yes, but there's a surprise, okay?
Okay.
While I was talking to you, I've just gotten word that Charlton Heston is going to be hosting the main part of the show, and you guys are going to have several interchanges during the show.
With Charlton Heston?
With Charlton Heston.
Oh, I would do that.
You are going to love Chuck. You're a fan, right? I mean, it seems that a lot of the younger people today don't like his pro-gun stance. You don't have a problem with that, do you?
I am a fan. I would consider myself a fan, sure.
Well, that's great. Hey, so all I need from you is for you to fax me your Social Security info, you know, for the tax purposes.
Okay.
As well as your T-shirt size and your mailing address, so we can send you some of these Jesse Rocks T-shirts, and we can have you try them on and get some promo photos, okay?
Okay.
Okay,
all right,
great.
Sure. So where do I fax this to?
Well, you know who this is, don't you?
Well, what was your name again?
Well, you know who it is.
Well, you're running this Jesse Rocks thing?
It's Hot Rockin' Ronny getting Hot Rockin'. You are the dumbest tool I've ever felt sorry for. Revenge on your stupid ass. Oh,
oh
my God.
Oh.
What an absolute, absolute, utter tool.
Oh,
oh my God, you're such a fool.
Oh, oh, what is, you know, yeah, first of all, you didn't get me.
Oh, you were gotten.
You
never
didn't get
in the
me.
History of the world has somebody so quickly thrown away every last bit of self-respect and principles to make a quick buck.
You didn't get me. I'm gonna plead. I was still, you know. Well, first of all, for anybody listening, this jerk who just wasted everyone's time is. You might know him. He used to have a show on the station until he got canned,
say it,
I guess. He got, you know, his show was taken away and
by
no one. By your show was replaced by this show.
Yep.
And you
stolen,
for some reason
stolen.
Stolen. No, not stolen.
Stolen.
No, not stolen. But you for some reason have wrapped your head around the insane idea that I have stolen your show, like you just said, and that I'm your enemy now.
You're beyond my enemy.
Oh, I'm beyond your. Okay, what am I? What
you
am
know,
I through
I don't even think there's a word for it. But if there was, you'd be it.
Uh huh.
Your name would be it. Hey, Tom.
Yeah.
You got those swim trunks ready? 'Cause Chuck Heston wants you to shove them right up your rear pipe.
Oh, that's sweet. Happy New Year to you too.
Hey, guy.
Yeah.
Why don't you just retire from any kind of dealings with the public this very instant? Because you are ruined, son.
I'm ruined. Oh yeah, sure I am.
You
hey,
are such a tool.
Hey, aren't you the let me think for a minute.
Hey, hang on.
Yeah?
Hang on.
Okay.
Hey y'all, this is your good buddy Ron Bob Ford on WCNTAM in Palmers Creek, Georgia. Right here in the good old US of A. My wife Wilma wanted me to thank all of those who came out to the peach pie eating contest we had over at Gus's Feed Store yesterday. Little Jimmy Moore sure can put away those pies, can't he? Well, here's one I know you'll love because I've been getting a ton of requests for it all day. It's by that new girl singer from Douglas, Georgia, Sheila Patton. It's called You Don't Know What It's Like to Love a Woman. So where was I? You are such a complete
total
fool.
No. I think the shoe's on the other foot right now, my friend.
What
was that?
What do you mean, what was that? That's
art. No. What was that, Ron Bob? Oh, isn't your name Ronnie Fuqua?
Well, that's my given name, but
yeah.
my name down here is Ron Bob Ford.
Ron Bob Ford. Oh, boy. talk about trading away any sense of integrity.
Oh, you got to be kidding me. Hey, listen, these rubes down here would never understand a name like Fuqua. They think I was from Mars or something.
Yeah, and what kind of music is that?
What do you mean? That's country. That's the good old U.S. of A music, country rock. Country, not even country rock, just straight up country.
Uh-huh.
The way we love it down here.
You're down here. That's the other thing. Where are you, in Louisiana?
Come on, get it out of your ears, son. It's Palmers Creek, Georgia. It's where it's all going on.
Oh, it's all going on in Tamer. What is that?
Miles,
Tamers Creek,
Georgia? Palmers Creek. It's 150 south of Macon.
Oh wow! So you're right. You're just 2.5 hours outside of Macon, Georgia.
We're right
oh,
there.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I didn't realize you were living so high.
Oh my God, it's great down here.
Hey, how much further are you going to fall down the radio ladder? Because you've gone from doing you were like Dr. Silk,
yeah.
for a while. Then you were trying to do something in Florida.
Yeah.
Which was like some RM, which was like a new, not FM or AM, it was RM.
It was like a new band, like a new frequency, yeah.
Yeah, and then you did that, then you went to like playing like marches on the radio.
Right.
So, and now you're stuck in Tamers Creek, Georgia.
You forgot one. Actually, you forgot two.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah. That's right. Oh, that's right. You were actually working for like a pharmaceutical company.
Yeah.
As like a PA announcer.
Yeah. I left Current Pharmaceuticals a few months ago. You know, things were going great until old Mr. Kern, he started treating me like a slave. You know, he got involved in this rascal racing league. Do you know about those rascals?
You mean the things that the senior citizens drive?
Yes, those motorized carts that seniors and heavy people drive around. And, you know, it's funny because Kern isn't really that old, and he doesn't have a weight problem, so he shouldn't even be in the league. But he struck some deal with the league where they'd let him drive, and he'd give them all the pep for life that they wanted when it comes back on the market.
All the what?
Pep for life.
What is that?
Well, it's this current pharmaceutical thing, like Skinny Slim, but this is like a natural energy booster. And when I say natural, I do use the term very loosely. I think the only way any kind of natural element comes into play is if you take it with a glass of water.
So he was running a rascal league?
Yeah.
What do you mean a league?
Well, it's like a league. You know, you compete. You know, you got all these guys who compete in the league. And, you know, these old people and these heavy people. And, you know, of course he always wins because he's got the best coordination, you know, because everyone else is so fat and so old.
Mm-hmm.
You know, getting back to the pep for life.
Yeah.
I can get you some if you want it, although I doubt you'll want it.
No thanks.
Well, it's getting retooled, and it's going to come out under a new name called Safety Pep. And my advice to you and your stupid listeners is to stay away from it, because the last time I took one, actually I took 10 of them, I was seeing life-size rats walking around my bed for a week.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's the other thing. You attempted to break the...
I did.
You attempted to break the Guinness record that was set by this station's own Glenn Jones.
Well, you know, I think you guys should actually be... Yeah, that clown should be disbarred because they shouldn't allow high school stations to be able to compete.
Well, first of all, you know this isn't a high school station.
No, it certainly is.
No, you're
well,
complete.
Compared to CNT, it is.
Well, what? No, is that the station you're on now?
Yeah.
CNT.
Yeah. Hey, hang on.
Yeah, that's the way to tell them, Brian. That's the latest from the number one artist on WCNT. That's Brian McLean. His new album is it cold in here or is it just you? And I'm pretty sure it's available at Guthrie's General Store and at the gas stop down in nearby Meltonsboro. I want to send out a congratulations to Myron Phelps over in Scottsville. He just got a new heifer, and he named it Bessie. Way to go, Myron. Okay. Here's the number one all-time artist in the history of WCNT radio. That's right, it's Jake Reynolds and his greatest hit, Your Love is Like a Night in the Woods. Yeah, way to use that old imagination, Myron. Bessie, that's a great original name for a cow. A bunch of tools down here, too.
Oh, so you just have complete contempt for the people down there.
Oh, come on, guy.
What? You're usually the one telling me how much you love all of the thing you're at, and it's where everything's happening. But you seem to be pretty contemptuous of the people of Parrots. Was it Parrotsville?
You gotta get that out of your ears, son. It's Tamers Creek.
Tamers Creek. Okay.
And no, I don't have contempt for them. I love these people. You know why?
Why?
Because they're making me really rich.
You're getting rich on a station.
You know how?
How?
I go into their barns at night and steal their farm equipment, paint it a different color, and then sell it right back to them. It's awesome.
you do not do that.
I do.
And you're bragging about it on the radio.
Yeah.
You're not. You have no fear of repercussions.
These people down here don't even have the internet. They couldn't possibly know about your teensy tiny high school show.
Uh huh. Yeah. Oh yeah. Oh, okay. Ron Rob.
It's Ron Bob Ford.
Oh, Ron Bob Ford.
Yeah.
Okay. And who was that artist you just announced?
You've never heard of Jake Reynolds?
No.
You've got to be kidding me.
Jake Reynolds.
Yeah, well, how about Sheila Patton?
No, I've never heard of Sheila Patton either.
Well, I got some news for you.
Yeah?
I never heard of him either. This town is so podunk that we don't even get serviced by any of the major labels. Half of the songs I'm playing are records from the 70s. I found in a thrift store in Macon. These dips don't know the difference.
So you just are going on playing these records that are just like just garbage.
You know what? As long as these tools have something to listen to while they're milking their cows, they're fine.
Wow, you really are pretty harsh there.
No.
Now, I'm perversely interested in this rascal racing thing.
Yeah.
You were saying that the guy who you worked for, Maurice Kern, was his name. He was.
Oh, you know what?
What?
He thinks you're a colossal tool, also.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, the feeling's mutual.
Oh, well, you know, I'm not that into him anymore either. You know, it's weird. He was so upset.
Hey, maybe he thinks you're a colossal tool.
Well, he might now, and I'll tell you why.
Why?
See, he was obsessed with his rascal racing,
mm-hmm.
and he started making me do all this work on his rascal.
Uh-huh.
I had to spit shine the whole thing every morning. He said spit shining was 1,000 times more effective than soap.
Spit shining?
Yeah. And, you know, I totally just had it one day.
Yeah?
I walked up to him. I yanked on his fat tie, and I said, "You're a douchebag." Then I stole his rascal and split. And I drive it as my main car now.
You drive a rascal as your main car?
Yeah.
And how... So what does that thing get up to, like, 2 miles an hour?
Something like that.
Wow.
But so you know what?
Yeah?
The ladies love it.
This is not true. The ladies do not love...
Oh, my God. I'm a god to them. It's funny. Every town I go to, I'm a god.
You're a god.
Yep. Oh, hey, what's your name, Tim?
Tom.
Oh, yeah, right. Guess who told me that you suck?
Who?
Guess who told me that you suck and that I should tell you that you suck?
Who?
Gorch.
The Gorch?
Yep.
Oh, that's another thing. You literally are the strangest guy going. You hang out with this guy, the Gorch.
I'm like Warhol.
Like Warhol.
Yep. I'm so weird, but I'm so cool.
Yeah, I guess you are like Warhol. But if Warhol drove a rascal and hung out with like a 70-year-old who claims that Happy Days was based on his life.
Hey, it's documented. You know, he lives with me here, too.
So he lives down in Georgia.
Yeah, you know, he actually helped me get even with old Kern.
How's that?
He shot his motorcycle through Kern's big office window. The damn thing wouldn't turn off. It was just shooting grease everywhere. It was just going all over the room. And Kern was out of his head with fright. I actually heard him load his pants from outside the building.
Oh. So the Gorch, was the Gorch on the motorcycle?
No, see, he was revving it. And he just, you know, he just barged through the front office and found out the office, you know, where the big office was. And he just, like, you know, he did the thing. He did the accelerator and let it fly.
So now he just pretty much could have killed someone.
Well, you know, I mean, you screw with Fuqua, you get the horns. You screw with the Gorch, you get the bike.
Wow, you guys, that's like a match made in heaven. Thank God the two of you found each other.
Guess what?
What?
I'm producing Gorch's new album.
Really?
Yeah, he's making a straight-up hard country album.
I guess inspired by the
by our
the great
our,
music
our environment
by Sheila Patton.
Yeah, you know, I'll give you a tip. All right, this is something you can put up on that FMU website if it's still up.
Yeah, it's still up.
This album is going to be called Old Fashioned Country Chain Fight.
Old Fashioned Country Chain Fight. So I guess it's like looking back to all those days where. People used to have old-fashioned country chain fights.
You know they did. Hey, hang on.
Oh.
Listen and learn.
Yeah.
Mercy sakes, wasn't that a good one? The I was the pride of Pearson County, Georgia. Yep, that's right. None other than Debbie Lynn Perkins with her hit, He Broke Her Heart, But She Broke His Wallet. You tell him, Debbie. Now, people, the fine folks over at Rogers Fertilizer have come up with a new line that's guaranteed to bring you the finest turnips and sweet potatoes you've ever seen. So go on down to Gus's Feed Store and buy a couple bags of Fantastifert. Alrighty, people, it's about time for me to sign off and turn the mic over to Brother Cletus Phelps. Yes, that's right, it's time for me to go down to church and help Reverend Parsons with his sermon for Sunday. I know I'll see each and every one of you at the potluck afterwards in the vestibule. So have a nice day. Yeah, I'll be there in church if I can turn myself away from the fine ladies up at Cloud 9 on Route 62 before 7 a.m. Oh, God, I need a drink.
Wow, that was a good one. Can I just ask you a question?
Yeah, shoot.
Now, you are in Georgia, right?
Yeah.
Are you in Georgia 2002, or is this like Georgia 1930?
Well, like I said, I adapt to the locals.
Sweet potato.
For all these people know, it's 1963.
You mean those people actually talk about sweet potatoes?
Well, yeah.
Oh.
It's good stuff.
You get what you deserve in life, I believe.
You know what I miss?
What?
High-quality lap dances.
Oh, what, you don't get those down there at
Cloud 9? No, you know, they're not that well-versed in the maneuvers down here. I mean, there's some good stuff, but, all you know, it's like, I'm so used to being, you know, like, as I said, like a god and a massive celebrity all the towns I go to, that I'm basically allowed to paw the women, and I can't really do that here. They really frown upon that.
Yeah, I guess they do. Maybe it's just you they frown upon.
I doubt it.
Yeah, I don't doubt it. God, you know, as I was saying, you get what you deserve in life, and you know, you kind of end up where you belong. And I think you have pretty much gotten yourself to where you are right now.
You are so jealous, A, of my talent, B, of the fact that I'm forging new inroads into country radio, and C, that I have an incredibly lucrative farm equipment business.
And farm equipment,
yes,
business. Oh,
you,
that's right. Oh, stolen a merchandise.
Oh, you're nitpicking.
Yeah.
And you, this is so sad, you are still at high school radio. I love it.
This is not high school radio.
Yes,
you know
are.
This is a free-form independent station, totally listener-sponsored. I guess we don't get the sponsorship of that general store or
it's
whatever
Gus's.
You were. It's Gus's. I'm sorry. I forgot. Your radio spots are so compelling. I don't know how it could have slipped my mind.
Hey, you know what Gus helps me with?
What?
He doesn't know it, but he supplies me with 50 bags of feed every night.
Why?
You haven't lived until you've seen Gorch steal 50 bags of feed and fertilizer.
Now you and the Gorch also. It's fitting that the two of you deserve each other. Are you two going to build a house down there and just live out the rest of your lives? Or?
We might, you know, but, you know, this area can't contain us. But, you know, I do have to credit him with teaching me the fine art of chain fighting.
Oh, so he's teaching you how to chain fight.
Oh, my God, yeah. And chains and pipes, you name it. We do it all.
Wow.
Yeah, sometimes we don't wear that much clothing either. But don't let that one pass
uh-huh.
your lips.
So you and the Gorch just...
It gets hot down here.
Yeah.
Hey, now, you know, I got to get a beer.
Yeah. Well, I need to ask you something about the Gorch. How is it that you would let a 70-year-old man crash his motorcycle into a thing which would pretty much put his life in danger, as well as anyone who would have been unfortunate to have been hit by the motorcycle?
Well, like I said, I was driven to it. You don't screw with HRR
mm-hmm.
and not expect...
Or RB, I guess you should say.
Well, you know, I still go by that name sometimes, Hot Rockin Ronny.
No, Ron Bob.
Well, that's my other name.
Yeah, that's your...
That's
your...
my name down here for the moment.
Yeah, for the moment.
Yeah.
And who knows? What? I wonder if there are any rungs left on the radio...
What, the climb?
The free fall that you're on.
Free fall? You gotta be kidding me, son.
Yeah. Hey, have you made it up to Macon yet on your Rascal?
Like, well, you know, I go there on record runs.
Yeah? Oh, that's right, to the junk shops.
not a junk shop. It's a thrift store.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, you are a sad, sad person, and you have done this to yourself.
So I'm loving it.
I'm sure you are. You're a sad man.
Oh, you're such a tool.
You are
still so upset that I clobbered that clown on your high school radio station. And you're so upset that I have continually better programming than you.
Yeah, you know, boy, I'd really like to be chained to a format of playing country records that no one knows.
Well, you know,
what?
All I can say,
uh-huh.
I remember telling you that I was not going to come back there.
Mm-hmm.
I am going to come back there.
Oh, really?
Yeah, swinging chains and pipes with my man, the Gorge, by my side. And get ready to have your head taken off.
Oh, you guys are gonna take my head off.
Yeah.
Well, I say bring it on. First of all, if you're coming on a rascal, do the two of you have rascals?
Actually, Gorge has the rascal right now.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the two of you will be riding on one rascal?
Well, no. I mean, I'll be coming up there via transportation. The Gorge will be coming via the rascal. But Gorge had a little accident.
Uh-huh.
And he's actually coming, he'll be coming from Montana, where he's recuperating.
So he's recuperating in Montana?
Yeah, he threw his hip out. He was loading some farm machinery onto our flatbed. And he threw a hip.
Uh-huh.
So he's out in Montana recuperating, but he will be coming via the rascal. You know what?
Yeah,
I might just let him do it, because he's going to get more of a thrill, because, truth be told, he hates you more than I do.
Mm-hmm.
So, get ready.
Yeah, I'll be ready. Oh, and so I guess I should pencil him in to show up around the year 2040, he's driving a rascal.
It'll be a lot sooner than that. I talked to him today. He said he got the thing up to 7.
7 miles an hour.
Yeah, so look out, friend.
Wow, I'll look out.
Look out, okay?
Yeah, I'm going to look out. And yeah, hey, you know what you should look out for?
What?
The bottom of the barrel, which apparently you are about to crash into.
I'll never see it.
You probably won't.
You'll see it before I do,
you friend. Hey, dummy. Stupid.
I can't hear you.
Hey, Ron Bob.
Yeah.
You're as dumb as ever.
Hey, douche.
I'm not. Hey, what's it like to get hung up on?
Tell me.
Oh, you creep. Oh, Hot Rockin' Ronny. I thought we were vanquished. I thought we vanquished that buffoon. But like a bad penny, he keeps turning up. Why don't we listen to a record real quick? It is 9 p.m. here. You're listening to WFMU East Orange, WXHD Mount Hope Worldwide on the World Wide Web at WFMU.org. Coming up in about 5 minutes, author Paul Collins, the author of Banvard's Folly. And again, I read the subtitle. 13 Tales of Renowned Obscurity, Famous Anonymity, and Rotten Luck. We will be talking to him about his book in a few minutes, but let's listen to something from David Dundero from his new album, Shooting at the Sun with a Water Gun, here on WFMU.
decisions are incisions. Much too late to make revision. Sorry's just a suture. Leave a scar into the future. Pencil's better than a pen. Really try to change it again. This time I spill the ink. Gone, stained what you think.
Hey, that was just something from David Dondero's CD, Shooting at the Sun with a Water Gun. We heard the song, If You Break My Heart. And you are listening to the best show in WFMU. It is 9:07, and I'm going to bring up my special guest, Paul Collins, right now. Do we have Paul on the line?
Hi.
Hey, Paul, welcome to the show.
Oh, thank you.
I should say that Paul Collins is the author of a book called Banvard's Folly, and it is subtitled 13 Tales of Renowned Obscurity, Famous Anonymity, and Rotten Luck. And I guess you can go buy it, right?
It's out there.
Okay. Now, the book is, how would you best describe the book if you had to give a shorthand description of it?
Portraits of the failure of greatness or near greatness.
Mm-hmm.
Would be greatness in some cases.
And it, I guess a lot of the people who are the subjects of the book, the time period seems to cover the, where does it start? At the 1700s, early?
Yeah, I think the earliest person in the book is Salmanazar, and he's around 1700.
Okay.
And the most recent figure is the physicist Blonde Low,
mm-hmm.
and he's from about 1903.
Yeah. Now, do you think you need a certain amount of time to pass before you can tell, before history tells, weighs in on where these people stand in the annals of greatness?
I think so. I mean, there's certainly, more recent people that I guess I could have written about. But, I wanted to pick people that I was quite sure had been forgotten.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there's a certain kind of inertia to historical reputation. And once someone's, it seems to be, as just sort of a rule of thumb, that a couple generations or so tends to sort things out. Once someone is out of living memory, that if they're still being remembered by people, they'll probably continue to be remembered. And a reputation at rest at that point tends to stay at rest. So, I was basically looking for people whose obscurity was confirmed.
Yeah. Now, I guess to give people a good idea of the type of people who are covered in the book, would you tell us about John Banvard, who's the the book is named after him?
Yeah, Banvard was a painter in the 1840s, and what he did was he actually started off as a scene painter on a floating showboat going up and down the Mississippi, and then became sort of a vendor, just going from town to town selling cigars and stuff like that, and making drawings of the river as he went up and down it. And what he did was he created a giant moving panorama. It was this very large painting that was stretched between two rollers on either side of a stage, and it had a hand crank on the rollers. And so you'd have a guy cranking away so that the picture was rolling across the stage as a kind of motion picture.
Now, how high did the panorama go?
Something like it was either 12 or 14 feet, something like that.
Okay.
And Banvard would be out in front, and he'd be and what he had done was he'd painted a panorama of the Mississippi River from its source all the way down to New Orleans.
Mm-hmm.
And he would give you this sort of guided tour as it rolled by behind him, and he'd give his spiel on what life on the river was like. And it was a tremendous hit. I mean, he became probably one of the first, if maybe not the first, American millionaire off of the arts.
Wow.
And played to enormous crowds in New York and Boston. He ended up going to doing shows in London and Paris. He performed for the royal family. Became tremendously popular, and he ended up retiring and going back to Long Island, actually, and building himself a replica of Windsor Castle to live in.
Out on Long Island.
Wow. Out on Long Island, out by Cold Spring Harbor. And what he and that was that for a while. But what happened was he decided to compete with P.T. Barnum in the museum business.
Mm-hmm.
And Barnum just cleaned his clock out, just completely ruined him. And the upshot of it was that Banvard, who had been this tremendously famous and wealthy man, he died more or less alone. Out on the Dakota frontier, and what family he had with him out there, they were so broke that they skipped out of town to avoid paying the funeral bill.
Wow! But at one point he was the preeminent. Was he considered an artist, or even more like a showman, as well, or was he just?
I think more of a showman, really. He had started off as a scene painter, and so he was very good at conveying. Kind of quickly and broadly a landscape and things like that. I imagine that if you went and looked up close at his painting, it might not have been technically impressive, but it was meant as a performance, and it was meant to be moving and, accompanied by music and his narration.
Now, how
and as that, it worked really well.
How long was the panorama? I know that there was a mention of 4-mile paintings in the...
It was known as the 3-mile painting, and it's it was... pretty generally considered the largest painting ever made. And he actually got literally dozens of imitations when people saw how successful he was. And, there were people claiming that they had 4- and 5-mile paintings.
Mm-hmm. That was one of the things that Barnum actually did.
Yeah, Barnum actually, in his museum, when he was ruining Banvard, he had a fake version of one of Banvard's paintings. I mean, that was one of the ironic things, is that Banvard's museum had kind of the real versions of all the various exhibits that Barnum had the fake and slapped together versions of. But Barnum was a genius at advertising, and Banvard wasn't.
Mm-hmm. So he just was able to wipe them out.
Yeah, well, Barnum was willing to flat-out lie in his ads. I mean, he would claim that they had all kinds of air ventilation systems in his museum, which they didn't. Mm-hmm. And but people were, especially during the summer, really wanted to go to a place that was well-ventilated and kept cool, and so they'd flock to Barnum's and sweated it out.
Now, how many people during the peak of John Banvard saw these the panoramas?
I think it was something like 2 million, because admission for his shows was typically 50 cents,
mm-hmm.
and we know that he made over $1 million. So, yeah, I mean, he played to pack houses in New York and London for months and months,
mm-hmm.
and he was very well known. And Dickens was a fan of it, and Longfellow had seen it. The royal family, and he was quite well known. But if you look in art reference books now, you won't find him.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, his paintings are gone too.
What happened to the actual canvases?
The rumor from back then is that they were shredded and used as insulation in local homes in Watertown, South Dakota.
Wow.
So
now, was that just because at that point, I guess motion pictures would have been up and running, and that was just, it was nothing important?
Pretty much. At that point, he died in, I think it was 1891.
Okay.
And so at that point, his paintings were 40 years old. They were pretty worn. Nobody really cared much about him anymore. And he was broke, and so all this stuff got auctioned off, and I guess whatever didn't get auctioned off just got abandoned.
Mm-hmm.
So nobody really gave it much thought at the time, I think.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Now I read that story originally in McSweeney's.
Right.
And that was which one? Actually, this leads to an interesting question. What was the first one of these that you had written up, and what drew you to this this subject in terms of the documenting things that were completely unheard of?
I guess what originally drew me to it, I mean, I've sort of had a fascination with it for a long time. Initially, it was probably about 10 years ago or maybe 8 years ago. In college, I started looking at old copies of, like, the Atlantic Monthly and Harper's,
mm-hmm.
and, magazines like that, Southern Literary Messenger, all these magazines from the 1800s. And when I started looking at them, I was just amazed, because I was an English major, and I thought I knew my stuff, especially 19th century American. And I'd look in these magazines, and I didn't recognize any of the writers. And it really floored me, because I thought I knew this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I started to realize that the people that we remember today and that we consider important today are not necessarily the same people that were well-known and considered important back then. And I think that's probably true of any historical period.
Yeah, I mean, there was that one interesting quote, the Ralph Waldo Emerson quote, that starts off the chapter on Delia Bacon.
Right.
That says that only Whitman and Delia Bacon are the two producers of genius.
This was in the 1850s that he said this, which, is now considered, people call it the American Renaissance. And this is when Whitman and Thoreau and Emerson and Hawthorne and Melville and Dickinson were all producing their greatest work.
Mm-hmm.
But that might not have been how people saw it back then. Of course, people thought Melville was insane when Moby Dick came out. So, yeah, I mean, what people think is great and important work, at the time, and then what people look back later at, are two very different things, and so I really realized that looking at old magazines and things like that, and so that's sort of what originally got me interested in this general idea of really just sort of going back to the original newspapers and magazines of the era,
mm-hmm.
and finding out who was well known and has been forgotten in the meantime.
Yeah, and I guess but the next step is to who, not only people who were forgotten, but these are spectacular.
Yeah.
People who were just sometimes as wrong can be, and they were doing it on the big stage where everybody was judging them, And, you know, a lot of times they had fads going, and then, you know, time obviously exposed them. But, you know, I guess at their peak, they were, all eyes were on them.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, some of the people in the book, I think one of the common threads for most of the profiles in the book is that these were all people who are quite dedicated and for the most part, really quite idealistic about what they were doing.
Mm-hmm.
And quite intelligent, even though some of them kind of look like crackpots in retrospect.
Mm-hmm.
That might not have been so obvious at the time. You know, there's one fellow in the book that's sort of originated the hollow earth theory that was popular for a while, and another one that believed in the healing medical powers of blue glass. And there was a huge fad for a couple of years in the 1870s where everyone was putting blue glass in their houses.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You know, and in retrospect, it looks kind of kooky, but, it seems serious enough to plenty of people at the time.
Yeah, and I guess it was when science was just starting to really, I guess you had the Scientific American judged, I can't remember the, Pleasanton.
Right, the blue glass, yeah. They put out a whole series of articles attacking him, and played a fairly large role probably in bringing him down. But, you know, like most fads, particularly most medical fads that don't actually work, I'm sure it was just a matter of time.
Yeah.
But, you know, even with the fact that back then, science was maybe not quite as stringent as it is today, I don't know if things have changed that much. I mean, I'm sure that someone 150 years from now will be able to write about things like feng shui and recovered memories and have a good laugh at the expense of people in the 80s and the 90s.
Yeah, exactly. And obviously you do need that distance between the time. There's no way you can do that now.
Right.
Because you still have people who are dedicating the prime of their lives to it and will fight to the death over it. You know who's an interesting person in the book? If you could tell us about Robert Coates, which I thought that might have been my favorite chapter because it just... I laughed out loud during the Robert Coates chapter.
Yeah, Coates was, I think he may have invented camp. He was an actor in London, and he was probably the worst actor ever. But the great thing about Coates was that he didn't realize it, and he loved acting so much, and he loved Shakespeare so much, that it didn't matter to him. And so he became famous. This was around... I guess the 1820s or so, he became famous in London for just being a horrible, horrible actor in plays like Romeo and Juliet, and people would come to see him just to watch how bad he really was.
Now he started off, he was like the only surviving son
of a wealthy plantation owner in Jamaica,
mm-hmm.
or in the Caribbean, And for a while he ran the plantation after his parents died and sort of dutifully, attended the business duties, but his heart was in the theater. And so he would always be in these island productions of various plays,
mm-hmm.
and sort of the more over-the-top and the bloodier, the better. And finally he just decided, I want to go to London and hit the big stage. And so he did. And so he showed up in London, and he was very wealthy from his plantation, so... He showed up in London all clad out in furs and diamonds all over his clothing. What one would almost imagine to be sort of almost like an Elton John stage outfit of the time, and demanded to be in a production. And so they let him go ahead. And what happened was the first night that he was on stage as Romeo, which was his favorite role and the one he almost always played, he was just so over the top in going through his death agonies in the death scene that when he finally flopped down on the stage dead, someone out in the crowd yelled, "Die again." And so he got up and he did it all over again. He ended up dying three times on stage while people just increasingly were cracking up. And eventually he was packing houses that way. People just came, with their rotten vegetables, and they'd bring things like live chickens into the theater and throw them on stage. and the wonderful thing about Coates, the reason I love him so much, is that I really think he didn't get it in a way. I mean, he didn't understand why people were showing up and why they were egging him on like this. He loved acting so much. And I think, in a weird way, I think a lot of people can relate to that. You know, there's lots of sort of weekend musicians and actors and writers out there. And even if you know you're not that great at it, you love it so much that you do it anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And he's sort of the greatest example that I can think of.
Yeah, now, he had that growing cult, and then he actually, when he confronts them at a point, was the audience kind of split, though? Weren't there people who were...
They were supporters of his, and he was actually, he had quite a few friends. He was a very generous guy. He was always giving to charities, and people who were not well off would come to him for money. So he had quite a few supporters, but there were always, you know, maybe half the audience was just there just to watch him wipe out. And finally, at one performance, he really sort of broke down the fourth wall, so to speak, and just turned to the audience and made this address. He addressed a poem to them about his detractors, which was just extremely bizarre for the time. I mean, actors didn't stop in the middle of their performances and interact like that with the audience, unless they were panto performers or something like that. Mm-hmm. He's really kind of an extraordinary guy. I don't know. I think that if he ever decides to do a period movie, I think John Waters should
take on
Robert Coates.
First of all, I should say my guest is Paul Collins, the author of Banvard's Folly, a great book, 13 Tales of Renowned Obscurity, Famous Anonymity, and Rotten Luck. And another funny thing about Robert Coates was how he was obviously the rich guy rolling through town, and he would just try to fix things. Like, he even wanted to change, like, to rebuild Shakespeare's, I forget what it was. It was...
His house.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, he wanted to buy it, and also the theaters around Stratford, the old historic theaters.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't think they were grand enough. You know, he loved Shakespeare so much that it hurt him to see how humble the guy had actually lived.
Uh-huh.
And so he just wanted to tear everything down and make it better. Fortunately, they wouldn't let him.
Mm-hmm. Now you there's like a nice addendum to the thing, because I guess when you're going through the 1700s and the 1800s, people's the life expectancy is so much shorter. So
yeah.
Once in a while, it also seems like everyone in the book somehow has the ability to live to 80 years old. Like they have to ride out their downturn for the full length of human life. And when he actually is an old man, there's actually a nice passage where, I guess, did people egged him on to do some Shakespeare?
Yeah, he eventually did start running out of money, and some of his investments failed, and so he went into sort of financial exile for a while. But then eventually he came back to London, and he was in his 70s at that point, I think, and people actually recognized him on the street. This is, you know, probably 20 or 30 years later. And we're sort of yelling out, "Hey, Romeo!" And he actually at a few parties and things like that, people sort of coaxed him to go into his old performances. And the weird thing was that by that point, melodrama had become so common, you know, by sort of the middle of the century,
mm-hmm.
In stage performances, that his really outlandish death scenes and things like that didn't seem that odd anymore. And so it was sort of strange for people to watch, because in a strange way, he'd been actually really ahead of the curve. And you know, what people thought was bizarre 20 and 30 years earlier seemed a lot less so by that point.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess in a strange way, he was validated in the end.
Yeah.
And he actually died walking away from a theater performance. So
he was run over by a...
By a carriage.
Yeah.
Out in the street in London, yeah. He sort of died as he lived, you know, by the theater.
Mm-hmm. Now, how do you go about researching someone as obscure as Robert Coates? I mean, what is out there available for things that are obviously 200 years old, and there's the books have not been reprinted? I mean, how How arduous was that for you to gather the research for the book?
It's a lot of work. I mean, a lot of it involves just hitting large-scale research libraries. I mean, in my case, fortunately, I was near University of California at Berkeley, their library, because I was living in San Francisco at the time.
Mm-hmm.
So I got a lot of stuff there. Also, New York Public Library is tremendous, and the British Library in London. Those are, and also the Library of Congress in Washington. Those are probably my top sources. Sometimes I'll also just find things seemingly by chance. You know, it's one of those sort of things where, kind of like when you hear a new word or a new name, and then all of a sudden you start noticing it everywhere. History is like that, too. When you become aware of someone or some movement or something like that, all of a sudden you start seeing it in places where you didn't notice it before when you're going through old books and old magazines.
Mm-hmm.
But hitting the big research libraries is probably the main thing. Mm-hmm. Also, it's sort of a good time to be a historian because of being able to work online. Pretty much all the research libraries have their collections online, cataloged online. And so you can go through their collections from home, and then if you find something you need, order by interlibrary loan or order a photocopy of a book.
Mm-hmm.
And that's actually a tremendous resource. I mean, I feel really lucky because, in another era, I would have logged just an immense number of miles tracking this stuff down.
Sure, sure. Again, my guest is Paul Collins, the author of Banvard's Folly. Now, going into the, I guess you also, when you're researching a lot of this stuff, did you find things overlapping? Like where, I mean, for example, the editor of the Scientific American was Beach,
right,
who was out to disprove the blue glass phenomenon. Meanwhile, he's busy building these pneumatic tubes. They're like the precursor to the subways. So, I mean, it's like the characters. There was some intersecting in a couple spots.
Yeah, it's in some places it's kind of like the historical version of 6 Degrees of Kevin Bacon. There are certain people that just seem to pop up over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
Nathaniel Hawthorne was another one. He turns up in three different chapters, always as a sort of secondary character, but he's and in quite unrelated stories. One's about a grape grower, another one's about the Shakespeare scholar. I can only think that it's just in some cases it's because there are people at certain times that are just all over the place.
Mm-hmm.
They're extremely active during a historical period. But yeah, sometimes too it's just that I start researching someone like Beach for one thing.
Mm-hmm.
In his case, I'd heard about his involvement with the subway first. He built the first subway in New York. Almost underneath City Hall. Mm-hmm. Without telling anyone.
Now that was
right under Boss Tweed's nose.
And that was the 1870s?
Yeah, that was the 1870 that he unveiled it.
So
and I mean, the long and short of that was that he came up with a very interesting system. Was more or less powered by giant fans that sort of sucked the train back and forth through the tube. And he had notions of running these tubes all over the city, and in fact, he had created a kind of wood laminate that you could make these tubes out of, that you could run them underground or above ground up on stilts. You could run them up kind of alongside buildings. It would have been a very Jetsons-looking kind of landscape.
Mm-hmm.
With these trains sliding around. But Tweed put a stop to it because there was an enormous amount of money that was going to be going into whatever subway system got built. And he didn't have any cut of what Beach was doing, so he made sure he put a stop to it.
Yeah, I guess the governor was the one who ultimately shut it down.
The governor was in Tweed's pocket, and even though the legislature approved Beach's plan, the governor vetoed it, and that was pretty much the end of that.
Now, an interesting thing for people who are involved with this radio station is that I guess one of the earliest test cases of that system was the one up on stilts was at the 16th Street Armory.
Right.
Which is where WFMU used to have its record fairs.
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
That armory is also where the New York Knicks played their first games, too, in the 40s. So it's been a lot of history attached to it. So you have the pneumatic tubes, the New York Knicks, and then our record fair. So it's just the pattern has been set. So now one other line of character you seem to profile in the book are, I guess, con men would be the general term for it. And I thought one of the most interesting characters would be William Henry Ireland, who...
Yeah.
And the chapter is called the clever dullard.
Yeah, Ireland was he was an 18-year-old law clerk. He was a clerk in a law office in London, and he was not considered to be a very bright kid. In fact, it was with some difficulty that his father managed to get him this position at this firm, and nobody paid much attention to him. Basically, what happened was, Ireland's father, Samuel Ireland, was a book collector. And so to try to please his father, what William Henry Ireland did was he forged signatures on old books to make them look like signed, you know, autographed editions, and took them to his father, sort of saying, look what I found. And his father was completely taken in. I don't think he ever suspected that his son was capable of doing such a thing. And it just sort of snowballed, and it went completely out of control over the course of a couple of years. At first, what Ireland would do is, since he knew his father was particularly interested in Shakespeare, he started inventing like legal documents and receipts and, you know, things that you wouldn't really expect a forger to bother with, but of William Shakespeare. And he was in this law office that was full of old documents, so he had a large supply of old paper to work with, and he found this way of getting old-looking ink, and he would forge these documents, really bizarrely written, actually, written what he thought Shakespeare should sound like, even though, you know, if you look at it today, it's really not that similar.
So he was pretty much putting an E at the end of every single word.
Yeah, lots of repeated letters, you know, all the consonants are go twice, and, you know, there'll be three E's, and and then he got more and more emboldened by this, and finally started telling his father that he had found this whole sort of treasure trove of Shakespeare documents out at this country house, and that they included lost Shakespeare plays. And you know, he's maybe 19 years old by this point. So at the age of 19, he set about to write a Shakespeare play. And in the meantime, leading scholars in London were coming in and looking at these things. The Prime Minister came and looked at it. Boswell, the biographer of Samuel Johnson, came in and wept when he saw these Shakespeare documents. People were really taken in by it.
Mm-hmm.
And the
great thing is, no one thought that this dumb 18-year-old, 19-year-old could have been the source of this.
No one ever suspected him. And in fact, later on, when people did start thinking something was up, they blamed his father, because they just didn't think William was smart enough. And to his dying day, his father never believed that William did it.
Mm-hmm.
He just couldn't believe that his son was smart enough to fool a good part of London.
Mm-hmm. Now he when he wrote the, I guess one he took one of Shakespeare's plays, and at the time there was a certain faction that didn't like the lighter elements in the plays, the humor.
Yeah, so he would rewrite them so that he'd find, you know, new versions of Shakespeare plays, you know, the original handwritten versions, uncorrupted by time.
Yeah,
and he would make the dramas more dramatic and the comedies less serious.
Mm-hmm.
Where, I mean, one of the real aspects of Shakespeare is that even the most tragic plays have elements of humor in them.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's one reason why people appreciate him. He really brings across the range of human experience. But at the time, people were kind of troubled by that, and they were troubled that he would have earthy humor mixed in with these tremendous philosophical passages, like in Hamlet. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, what Ireland did was, he, in general, he gave people what they wanted to hear, you know, what they wanted to believe about Shakespeare. And so if you look at it now, it doesn't really look that much like Shakespeare, but people wanted to believe that it was.
Yeah. Now he kept crediting, he wasn't, he said that there was this man who kept giving him these things, or...
Right, this country gentleman who was generously passing these things along to him, who didn't want to be identified because he didn't want the publicity, and was promising him all kinds of money. He was a very generous fellow.
Yeah, I mean the guy just had, apparently he had everything in his in his house.
And the more stuff that Ireland promised, sort of the deeper he got himself in. I mean he claimed that there was an autobiography of Shakespeare there, and he found a second undiscovered play.
Mm-hmm.
And he really started getting in over his head. Mm-hmm. And what eventually happened was that the play that he had written from scratch, called Vortigern, was produced on Drury Lane in London. And it had one and only one performance because basically a riot broke out. And the show closed before it had even finished the first performance. And the funny thing is, it's actually not a terrible play. But at that point, these discoveries had become so controversial that the crowd there was just out of control. I mean, it included like a member of parliament who mooned the audience. It was sort of a mixture of controversy and a lot of drunk people that basically brought down the show.
Now, I just want to say this is an aside for the dummies in my audience. You can see that there's like people mooning and there's riots and things in this book. So it's not just all smart stuff.
No.
So for the people,
there's plenty of people acting foolish too.
Exactly. So they can get a lot out of it also. So this isn't some highbrow book. It's actually a legitimately funny book and very entertaining. And if anybody has any phone call, any questions for Paul Collins, the number is 201-200-9368. And now you said one common thread throughout the characters you selected for the book would be that they all tended to believe in what they were doing. Are there any other commonalities that you can that stood out for you?
The fact that they had been forgotten as well, but also that I think that a lot of them, in a way, couldn't even see what they were doing, or they were so completely focused on what they were doing that in a lot of cases, their downfall, I think, came as a real shock to them.
Mm-hmm.
And I suppose that's true of a lot of people who have achieved great success, that... you know, you don't see it coming.
Mm-hmm.
But also that a number of the people in the book, I think if you had gone to people back then and asked them whether or not these people would be remembered, in a lot of cases, they would be just shocked to know that they weren't well known today.
Yeah.
I mean, I think in the 1850s, people probably assumed that Banvard would be well known. Also, there was another chapter in this book is about a poet named Martin Tupper.
Yeah,
and Whitman once credited Tupper as being more or less responsible for Leaves of Grass having gotten written. And Whitman was sort of like that. He also said the same thing about opera, but nonetheless, I mean, Tupper was a pretty important influence, and he was one of the most popular poets of the 19th century. He had a book called Proverbial Philosophy. It was a tremendous seller. It was the Queen's favorite book, and sold something like 1 million copies in the U.S., which is a lot of copies for a book of poetry today. And
sure.
Back then, it's absolutely enormous. And so I think back then, people would have assumed that Tupper would stay famous.
Mm-hmm.
However, he's been out of print for about a century now.
Wow. He actually had to, live watching the next generation revolt against his I guess he was a pretty moral.
Yes.
did a lot of moralizing in his poetry.
He was the kind of poet that parents like to give copies of his books to their kids, you know, to keep them on the straight and narrow.
Mm-hmm.
And not surprisingly, once those kids grew up, they really hated him and really kind of knocked the stuffing out of him. And a lot of people parodied him and his name, and your listeners have the Oxford English Dictionary sitting around. It actually became a word. It became an insult. I think the word is Taparian.
Mm-hmm.
And it was coined by critics back then if they wanted to really insult a new poet in a review. They'd call the guy's work Taparian. I mean, he went from being the most famous and sort of favored poet of his time to being an insult.
But it just the volume is amazing. Again, just touching back on that, it's just a million. Just this guy moving a million books during that. And I guess the other thing that doesn't happen now is that at that point you didn't necessarily get rich when you sold a ton of stuff because there was just so much pirating going on and so many counterfeit copies.
Yeah, this was before. Copyright laws were very well enforced, or even existed in some cases, and so especially for British writers, it's actually kind of difficult to find American editions of their work from the 19th century that they made money off of, because mm-hmm. almost every edition that you see of Dickens and people like that, it was pirated all over the place, and so. Yeah, that's why you get a lot of these writers having to, become editors at magazines or go on speaking tours or things like that, because they weren't necessarily seeing very much money off of their books.
Mm-hmm. Now, one other, let me just say, first of all, once again, Paul Collins is my guest, author of Banvard's Folly. The phone number is 201-200-9368 if you have any questions. You can also email them at toms@wfmu.org. And, one other character who stood out, I thought, was interesting was George. I'm so bad at saying the last
Salmanazar.
Name. Salmanazar, yeah.
Yeah, his name's a bit of a tongue twister. Salmanazar showed up in London around 1700 and claimed to be a. He was the first Formosan to reach Europe, what we would call Taiwan today. And, you know, he spoke and wrote Formosa, and he practiced this Formosan religion that no one had ever seen before. And he had a very strange diet. He kind of lived off of grubs and roots and raw meat. When he showed up in London, he was sort of taken around to all the nobility and wealthy merchants. He was a great curiosity to people. And there were kind of a couple problems with this. The first was that he wasn't actually Formosan. And he had never been to Formosa either, and he wasn't speaking Formosan. He was making everything up, and we don't actually know what his real name was. We don't even know where he was from. He's a complete cipher, and he lived in this identity for decades. And in fact, later on, and he lived to be quite old. He lived into his 80s. And later on in his life, He really got embarrassed by it. He really wanted to break out of this identity that he had created for himself. He originally created it because he was a teenager, sort of out on the road on his own,
mm-hmm.
and he wanted a good way to beg to get people's pity. And so he came up with this wonderful story about how he was stranded far, far from home and didn't know anyone, and people fell for it. And back then, almost nobody had ever actually been to Taiwan or met someone from there. And so he was able to just make up anything he wanted. He invented his own calendar, his own language, his own letters,
mm-hmm.
All this stuff. This was when he was like 16 years old.
And he was saying that this was the Formosan, or the Formosan calendar and the language.
Right.
And he actually, got kind of busted by a I forget who it was.
It was a Jesuit priest. What happened was he claimed that, the only people at that point that had been to Formosa were some Jesuit missionaries, and which is why he was able to pull off this deception, because no one had been there, pretty much, and no one even knew what the people from there looked like.
Yes.
So Salmanizer had blonde hair, you'd think would be kind of a tip-off that he might not be Asian.
Yeah.
People didn't know.
You have this pale blonde guy, and he just says, "I'm from Japan."
Yeah,
and
exactly.
And everybody was just, "Oh, obviously you're from."
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
He actually went to the point where he wrote a history of Formosa, and a description of its geography and the island's resources and all this, and he illustrated it too with all these illustrations of temples and costumes of what people wore. And it was a tremendous seller. It went through multiple editions in London, Amsterdam. It was translated into different languages. He made it up, and he wrote it in like 2 months. He was a really amazingly inventive teenager, and he had to live in that identity for decades.
Now, a lot of the things he came up with he would just get more and more outrageous, saying how life in Formosa was lived with there was sacrificing of children.
He talked about thousands of children a year getting sacrificed in their religious ceremonies. And he came up with what I think was sort of a brilliant rule of thumb, which was that that anything that he said in a conversation when he was talking about Formosa, he would never, ever go back on. So no matter how outrageous of a statement he made, he would not back down on it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how he kept his credibility for so long, because, you know, with a deception like that, when someone starts changing their story, that's when you sort of start realizing that maybe they're being deceptive.
Yeah.
But he was absolutely insistent upon everything he said, and that's why it worked. And in fact, people still sort of believed in his story, even when he was in his 70s and 80s. And in his old age, he became very repentant, very sort of pious old man, and actually was a great friend of Samuel Johnson. Someone once asked Samuel Johnson who he thought the best man in all of London was, and he said Salmanizer. And he described Salmanizer as being a saintly man. And this was in Salmanizer's later years when he was, I think he tried to live down what he had done earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Even then, people still wanted to ask him about Formosa, and it really pained him.
So he created this character. And I guess he got benefits from it that he never would have gotten if he was just a normal slum.
Yeah, I mean, basically he was a poor kid with nothing, and he was more or less able to dine off of his story, and you know, people would put him up in their house and that sort of thing. Mm-hmm.
But at a point he grew to regret ever having done.
Very much so. And he became trapped in this identity of you know, the identity of a non-existent country, basically, and culture, and he couldn't get out of it.
Yeah. Well, we have a question on the email here from Daniel. What effects will the internet and all the various media outlets we have today have on the Paul Collins type researchers of the future? Will they be able to sift through it all to find the exceptional failures?
It helps a lot. I mean, you know, the funny thing is I was doing a lot of the research for this book right after my son was born and when I was being a house dad. And, you know, and that's such a sort of an enveloping task while you're doing it that a lot of the time, the only time I could do work was in the middle of the night. And going online was a tremendous resource. You know, it doesn't matter what time you go on. You can check the library catalogs and whatnot. And so it's already making a big difference. There's one resource out there called it's called Making of America, and it's this consortium with Cornell University and a bunch of other places where they're digitizing old magazines and newspapers and putting them online, and you can do word searches and things like that. It's an absolutely tremendous resource. I mean, you can find stuff using that website that I don't know how you'd find it otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
So it's definitely making a difference, But the thing is that, I mean, there's sort of two things about the internet. One is that you have to have someone looking for it in the first place. You know, you can have all that information out there, but if you're not looking for it to begin with, they're going to be just as obscure as ever.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing is that, you know, there is something to be said for paper. It's an incredibly stable medium, and it lasts hundreds of years. It doesn't need operating system upgrades. It doesn't get erased, or not easily.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know whether a lot of things being produced today will be around for historians a couple hundred years from now.
Yeah, yeah.
Because in a way, electronic media is much more fragile over the long term than things like paper.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'm actually a huge fan of Nicholson Baker. Last year put out a book called Doublefold, all about how libraries are, number of libraries were microfilming and digitizing their old newspaper collections, and then throwing out the newspapers. And, you know, for someone like me, that's just horrifying, because microfilm and digitizing are really useful tools, but you want to keep the paper, because that's what you know is going to last.
Mm-hmm.
And that's really what historians, in the end, have to rely on.
Now, a related question would be, do you think that with all these, the tools that are available to people, I mean, obviously now there could be another Salmanazar using the internet, or, you know, just people can, it just seems like those tools now open up the possibility of people who want to pull one over on somebody, just have more, like they turn the things that are research tools into like tools of deception.
Oh, and, sure.
And it just,
I mean, anytime you get a new technology, you get that. You know, I'm sure that very shortly after the first phones were installed, you also got the first examples of phone fraud. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just anytime you get a new technology like that that gives someone extra leverage, you'll always get people that use it that way. It's why I think there was a story on the front page of the Times today about some 17-year-old kid in California who did a huge pyramid scheme, investment scheme, and built like 1,000 people out of their money.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I mean, absolutely. It's, you know, that's just, I think that always comes along with any new technology. You get a lot of usefulness out of it, and you also, you know, until people learn to wise up, you get all kinds of fraud accompanying it. Mm-hmm. I mean, sort of like with Salmanazar, you know, once more people had been to Formosa and there were more reliable accounts coming out of there, you know, then his scheme really didn't work so well in
yeah.
much later years. Mm-hmm. But initially, people, you know, it was sort of a whole new area for them. People didn't know.
Mm-hmm.
And so they believed him. And technology is the same way, too. You know, eventually, probably some of the old routines on phones and telegraphs and things like that, you know, people wise up to them.
Yeah. Yeah, I got a question here from Nick emailing it. He asks if you have ever been to the New Bedford Whaling Museum up in Massachusetts, because they have a panorama painting of a whaling journey up there.
Huh? No, I haven't seen that one. Panoramas were really, they were a really popular art form at that time, and so there are still some around. Banvard's, unfortunately, seem to all have gotten destroyed. There's a few small paintings of his that still exist, but yeah, there's still a few around. I haven't seen that one, though, and I'd like to. Mm-hmm. I know there's another one, I think, at Gettysburg, and they actually found a large moving panorama, not unlike Banvard's, it was a museum up in Maine. Let's see if I can dig it up here. It's the York Institute Museum in Saco, Maine. And they discovered it in a storage room. It had been sitting there for about a century, just totally forgotten.
Wow.
And they restored it, and I think starting a couple years ago, they started to put it up on exhibit. So there's at least one of Banvard's sort of imitators still alive out there, so to speak, that can be seen.
Got another question on the internet here from Sean in Denver. Wants to know, first of all, what's your background, and secondly, Are you going to be putting any similar books like this out in the future? Is this a line you're going to keep pursuing?
I'm actually working right now on a sequel to Banvard Folly. It's called The Monkey's Uncle. Mm-hmm. And I've already pretty much finished researching it, and I'm about halfway through writing it. So hopefully, maybe the end of this year, early next year, that'll be out.
Mm-hmm.
And as far as my background, I started off studying literature, American literature primarily, 19th century, and it just sort of branched out from there. I mean, a number of the people I write about in the book are scientists and people like that.
Mm-hmm.
But that was sort of what initially got my interest was literature. And in recent years, I've just been writing full time, working as a historian, basically.
And once again, the phone number is 201-200-9368, or the email is thomas@wfmu.org. You can email in your questions, but it would be nice to hear somebody tell Paul how entertaining he's been to his face, or his voice at least.
Just
not put your question on the computer. Now, is this line of thing? I mean, are there people who, your book obviously takes on 13 subjects. Now, are there people out there who are just document John Banvard? Like, that's their sole focus? And you're doing kind of like a summarization of something that somebody's life's work. I mean, I'm just wondering
in a few cases there are. Yeah, in the case of John Banvard, there is actually kind of uniquely in the book, there is someone that is a bona fide expert in Banvard. And his name is John Hanners, and I think he's at Bowling Green University or something like that. He put out a book about 10 years ago or something called it was Play or Starve, I think, was the name of the book. And a large section of that book is about Banvard. But basically what I tried to do for this book was to pick people that were not well-known and had not been written about recently. In a few cases, there are people in the book that might be known to a fairly small community of scholars, like Banvard was to really just a few people.
Mm-hmm.
Or in the case of Blonde Lowe, who's a French physicist who thought he had discovered a new form of radiation at the turn of the century, and he was kind of like the 1900 equivalent of cold fusion. It just sent scientists all over the world on this wild goose chase for this what turned out to be a non-existent form of radiation.
Mm-hmm.
And he's actually probably fairly well known to physicists. He's often brought up as an example of how not to do your research.
Yeah, that was one of the most heartbreaking.
Yeah, it really was.
In the book, because the one scientist who is going to be his Moriarty, I guess, who's got to the guy out to disprove him, and he's he shows up and he's just watching them run the test on these the N-rays, and it's just when you realize that they're just pulling, that it's just they're pulling a fast one, it breaks your heart.
It really is, and the worst thing is that ultimately it seems like Blonde Lowe was more self-deceived than a deceiver.
Mm-hmm.
So it's he's quite a sad story. But again, he's probably well known to a fair number of physicists,
mm-hmm.
but not outside of that community particularly. The same with William Henry Ireland. Shakespeare scholars know about him, but.
Mm-hmm.
Other people didn't, so that's why I picked them.
Okay.
But there are other people in the book, like Pleasanton, the blue glass guy, Robert Coates, the actor, that nothing has been written about them, as far as I can tell, in the last century.
Mm-hmm.
And so I one of my real hopes with this book is that other historians will pick up from where I've started with, sort of these short essays, and go and write full books about these people. Mm-hmm. I think that would be wonderful.
We got a call coming in here. Let's punch it up. Oh.
Hello?
WFMU, you're on the air.
Oh, hi. I emailed actually earlier with a question, and I think it was misinterpreted. My name is Daniel.
Okay.
And I was asking about, the internet and other media. And what I meant by my question was, we have so much media today that, certainly more than there was, 200 years ago. Mm-hmm. And there's so much more hype about things that, how will future historians be able to recognize, I don't want to say colossal failures, because I think that's kind of doing a disservice to the people that you write about, but how will future historians be able to tell, who was big and then had a precipitous fall if, there's so many more outlets that have to be researched from this period?
It's hard to say. Time has a certain way of culling these things out, certainly, but... We don't have a monopoly on hyperbole in our own era.
Right.
It certainly seems like it. I think because it seems so nonstop. We're bombarded by advertising and things like that.
Yeah, yeah.
In a way now that probably wasn't the case 100 years ago. But that said, they certainly had that too. And actually, in the case of Banvard, it's really a perfect example, because he was not prepared for that when he went up against Barnum. And Barnum had an amazing ability at hype, and that's what ended up doing Banvard in. And so, if you're a historian and you go back and you look at that stuff, you do to some extent need a BS detector. When you read some of these stories sometimes you just realize you have to take them with a grain of salt. It also helps to be able to find corroborating accounts or primary materials, firsthand reports and letters and things, as opposed to newspaper stories.
Right, right.
So, all these things sort of have their place in terms of doing research, but, the closer you can get to original sources, usually the better off you are.
Right, right. And so, here's actually a second kind of unrelated question. But do you kind of see your book as the scholarly or History Channel version of VH1 Behind the Music?
There certainly is a certain arc that all those careers tend to take when they do it on VH1.
Right, right.
I hadn't really thought of it that way, but I guess there is a certain similarity.
Yeah, really, what's the difference between Milli Vanilli and the guy who said he was from Formosa?
The difference is that the guy from Formosa could probably sing.
See, wow.
National songs of Formosa, probably.
Yeah. I think that there is probably a certain fascination that people have with great rises and falls, and that's what pulls in the audience for a show like that.
Right.
And to some extent, that's probably what pulls in people for this book, but I think it's also possible to misinterpret it, because, a few people have, when they've written about the book, have sort of described the schadenfreude that you get from it, or, mm-hmm. The sort of pleasure in watching people fall. And that's not actually what I wrote it with the intention of. I sort of meant it more as a celebration of these people.
Yeah, yeah, because, I think it's better to get schadenfreude out of, people living today.
Well, yeah. And people who deserve it.
Yeah.
But, these are people that, even the con men, like Salmaneser in Ireland, in a way I found them sort of sympathetic, because, if nothing else, because they got it really in over their heads. And it's hard not to feel sorry for them,
right.
Even as they were being incredibly inventive and deceptive.
Yeah.
A lot of the other people were, just smart, idealistic people. Often very sort of single-mindedly pursuing something, I like to feel like I'm, helping bring them back to light a little bit, and finding some of the admirable things about what they did, even if they didn't succeed.
Yeah, letting them know that their efforts weren't for nothing.
Yeah,
yeah, exactly.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Thanks for calling.
Thanks.
Okay. Well, I've got to. The old clock on the wall tells me I've got to wrap this up. So, Paul Collins, once again, the book Banvard's Folly. Thanks for coming on and spending some time with us and
thank
telling
you.
Us about the book. And we'll look forward to the monkey's uncle now.
Oh, thanks.
Coming. What's one little like one sentence teaser from someone from that book you can give us?
One of the things I'm working on right now is actually the chapter I'm writing at the moment, so it's it's the one on my mind, is about attempts in the 19th and early 20th century at controlling the weather, including C.W. Post, the serial millionaire.
Uh-huh.
He used to send up kites loaded with dynamite and try to blow rain out of the sky.
See, you already got one customer now tonight waiting, me, who will just be checking off. I can't wait for 2002 to end so that I can get your next book. Well, thanks again for coming on. I appreciate you taking the time.
Oh, thank you.
And you have a good night.
You too.
Oh, great. Thanks. Bye.
Bye.
Okay, let's get back to the music. Hey, you're listening to WFMU East Orange, WXHD Mount Hope Worldwide on the World Wide Web. Here is something from Harper's Bazaar.
Hey, everybody. We're back on the best show on WFMU. Oh, we just heard from Moto, Masters of the Obvious, checking in with It Tastes Just Like a Milkshake. One of the many great songs on this Little Teddy collection, compiling the best of the label Little Teddy Records. Before that, Cobra Verde from their five-song EP that is pretty much unavailable, I believe, commercially. We heard Modified Frankenstein. Nice work from them. Ah, before that, from the compilation U.S. Pop Life Volume 13, Northeast New Core, Parallel Universe of Exterior and Interior. We heard New York's Oneida with Mr. Clean. And starting us off, Harper's Bazaar from Harper's Bazaar 4. Actually, a bonus track, If We Ever Needed the Lord Before. That's what we heard. My name is Tom Scharpling here on the best show on WFMU until 11. At that point, we will turn the microphone over to Nickel and Dime Radio with Small Change. But right now, it's Open Phone Tuesday, 201-200-9368. The phones are open, wide open. It's the time for you to call. Any questions or comments? This is it. 201-200-9368. Or you can email in a question at toms@wfmu.org. toms@wfmu.org. And remember, if you're interested in that Friends of Tom membership card, just email me, toms@wfmu.org, and you'll get your very own card sent out to you post-haste. WFMU, you're on the air.
Tom.
Yes?
Is Tom there?
This is Tom.
Can I speak to Tom, please?
This is Tom.
Oh. Tom, it's Paul Crenshaw. How you doing?
All right. Hey, how are you, Paul?
Well, yes.
Now, you're the, you've called before, right?
Called up three times before, yes.
Uh-huh. And you work in a an office, right? You're the office guy who's...
I work at a mortgage company.
Uh-huh.
And earlier in the year, just to capsulize the past 8 months of my life, earlier in the year, of course, our company experienced a lot of layoffs.
Mm-hmm.
And I was not laid off, but I was actually promoted to a supervisory position.
Okay.
That had opened up due to the layoffs.
Mm-hmm.
So I was now, you know, I had become the boss of individuals that were previously my contemporaries.
Yeah, so you all of a sudden took charge of that division
the
of
office,
your...
I became the office manager.
Okay.
Yes. And I immediately, there was a lot of jealousy.
Mm-hmm.
And I immediately began to be mistreated by individuals who are now my charges.
Mm-hmm. Now, the last time you called, I remember, was kind of creepy because it sounded like you got into some kind of scuffle with a coworker or something over the, like, you were on the phone and you were getting yelled at for being on the phone.
I was working late because nobody really does the work around there, so I have to stay and do it. And, yes, an intern got very upset that I was on a personal phone call.
An intern got upset?
Yes.
Well, what would it, if you don't mind me saying, what would an intern care?
They all have it in for me there.
Oh, well that, and what happened to you?
He actually hit me in the head with a Swanson's frozen dinner.
Uh-huh.
And the phone was then disconnected.
Yeah, I mean, because you sounded like you were getting brutalized.
It wasn't. Well, It wasn't pretty, but nothing to compare to last month.
Mm-hmm.
Last month was the worst month yet.
And really?
I will say right now that this is probably the last time that I'm going to call you. I may not need your advice anymore.
Okay.
But I will say that last month, December, was really rough.
How was it?
I'm lucky to be talking to you right now.
Really? It was that rough?
Around the office, yes.
Well, what happened?
Well, we had a Christmas party at the office,
mm-hmm,
of course.
Sure.
And I suggested and subsequently organized a Secret Santa. Which, do you know what a Secret Santa is?
Yeah, it's where you everybody puts their names in like a hat or something, and you draw.
Right.
Everybody draws one person. That's who you buy a present for.
Right. That's correct. And then I, on the recommendation of one of these coworkers that I've had a problem with in the past, but
mm-hmm.
You know, I'm a glutton, and I still glutton for punishment rather, and I still continue to listen to them and take their advice. That one of them recommended a Santa Claus, a man to actually dress up as Santa Claus and be the master of ceremonies at the party and to hand out the gifts. But, and I went with it. I
mm-hmm.
contacted this guy. He seemed straight enough, you know.
Okay.
And the night of the party, I get there a little bit early, and I go to the bathroom. And Carl, who's one of my charges, on paper at least,
uh-huh.
one of my charges, Carl, is blocking the bathroom door. And I said, "Why, Carl, I need to use the restroom." He said, "No, you can't come in here right now. Santa's in there."
Uh-huh.
Like, okay, well, the bathroom has several stalls, Carl. I just need to, you know, relieve myself. Can I please come into the bathroom? He's like, "No, you'll have to wait until Santa gets done."
Okay.
So, Santa was actually in the bathroom, or this man, I don't even remember what his name is, that I hired to be a Santa,
mm-hmm.
was actually in the bathroom for an hour and a half.
Uh-huh.
And he kind of emerges out of nowhere, and I had so much to think about at this point that I just didn't know what to really say about it, and I was busy trying to get the party going, and
yeah.
And we all sit down, and there's the Christmas tree, all of the gifts are under it, everybody brought their gifts to work, and I noticed that, you know, everybody's sitting around, and Santa's getting ready to give out the gifts, and I look over, and I notice that he's, the man that I'd hired for Santa, he's in a Santa suit, and he's sitting in his chair, and he's nodding off.
Uh-huh. Wow. So, and this is the guy you hired.
Right. And so somebody tries to wake him up, and he just kind of does the best that he can to give out the gifts. And I had chosen a co-worker, a female co-worker, to, you know, for my Secret Santa, and the person that I was going to give a gift to.
Mm-hmm.
And so I got her a book, and I think was very thoughtful on my part. It's called Stop Screaming at the Microwave. Have you heard of it? It's a bestseller.
No.
How to Connect Your Disconnected Life by Mary LaVerd.
Okay.
I highly recommend it. It's, anyway.
Okay.
Regardless,
sure,
I'm just
sure.
trying to
yeah.
state that I put some thought into this. I'm trying to play by the rules here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's pretty easy to do a Secret Santa.
Right.
Right.
So the gifts are getting passed around by this, like, half-conscious Santa.
Mm-hmm.
And I noticed that gifts are just starting to pile up on my desk.
Okay.
I have at least 7 or 8 more gifts than anybody else.
On your desk?
Yes, that are for me.
Yeah. Now everybody's doing Secret Santa, though.
Right.
Okay. So
I didn't understand it. I didn't understand it myself, Tom. And then I understand it now.
Mm-hmm.
It turns out that the Secret Santa bowl had actually kind of been rigged by another coworker so that every coworker of mine chose my name plus another person's.
Okay.
So everybody had
to buy you a present,
right?
In addition to someone,
right?
Else.
And I said, why did you guys do this? And they said, well, we know you've had a rough year, Paul. We know you've had a really rough year. We decided it'd be appropriate if everybody in the office got you a gift.
Uh huh.
I thought, wow, you know, maybe everything's coming around.
Sure. I mean, maybe it's around the holidays.
Maybe they finally
people...
realize, yeah. Maybe the holidays have instilled some goodwill in these people, and they finally realized how they've been treating me all year.
Yeah.
That it's wrong, and that they need to maybe make up for it, and this is a start. So I have these 8 gifts on my desk. So I begin to unwrap them, and of course, as I fell for it again, Tom.
Well, how...
Every time I think that somebody in the office has turned around, or they're going to do something nice for me,
mm-hmm.
It's just guess who's the gullible one? Me.
And what did they do?
The first gift that I unwrapped. Are you familiar with the board game Sorry?
Sure.
It was a Sorry board game, but it was doused in kerosene.
Uh-huh.
And it quickly began to ruin my desk.
Well, why would they do that, though?
You tell me. I don't know. They've been doing
that's like such a deliberately malicious thing. I can't believe that for, like, Christmas, that somebody would do something that outright evil.
I just threw it off the desk. I threw it onto the floor.
Sure.
I was like, and I threw it onto the floor.
Mm-hmm.
And they kept saying, open your next gift, Paul. Open your next gift. Mm-hmm.
So now, by this point, were you a little wary?
I guess so, yes. And I opened the next gift, and it was a melted videotape copy of You've Got Mail. Like a copy, a videotape copy of the movie You've Got Mail, but maybe one that had been sitting all summer long in the back seat of a car.
Uh-huh. Wow.
And they kept saying, open your next gift, Paul. Open your next gift. In unison, even the Santa Claus, who now had grown men and women sitting in his lap.
Uh-huh.
Which was an uncomfortable sidebar to the party, of course.
Yeah, yeah, that's kind of grotesque.
They were chanting in unison, open your next gift. And I opened the next gift, and it was a box of used yard darts.
Uh-huh. Yard darts? Like...
The toy that is now illegal?
Those are banned.
Right. I got a box of used yard darts, and a coworker, John in sales, yells, take it home to the kids, Paul.
Oh, that's not even funny. That's horrible. How could somebody even encourage that on any level?
I don't know. I mean, I'm these people's boss.
Yeah, but, I mean, even beyond that, that's just like, there's not, you know, whatever differences they even have with you at work, it shouldn't go to where your kids get involved.
My kids are involved enough so that my wife and kids have left me.
They left you?
Yes.
Over what? Over this?
Over just my workload, because nobody else was doing work. I was never home. My kids left me a while ago.
Oh, that's horrible.
So they're all chanting in unison still. See, I still have gifts to go here, Paul, Tom.
Uh-huh.
I still have gifts to go.
Yeah.
And one's an envelope, and I open it up, and it's an enrollment in a series of rebirthing sessions. Do you know what a rebirthing session is?
No.
It's some sort of, it's very expensive, and they kept saying to me, you better go take the classes, because they kind of cost us a lot of money,
and it's some new age type thing where a woman basically brings out all of your childhood horrors and basically rebirths you from your mother's womb.
Mm-hmm.
And they cost hundreds and hundreds of dollars, and that's what they got me an envelope with a gift certificate for a rebirthing session.
Uh huh.
Which I didn't really know what I was just.
Yeah,
What's next, you know? And open your next gift. Open your next gift.
Uh huh.
My next gift was are you familiar with what a bobblehead doll is?
Sure, sure.
They had a bobblehead doll made in my likeness.
You mean like a ceramic bobblehead doll?
Yes, they had one made in my likeness, and it was not flattering. And again, with that gift, that cost us a lot of money.
Yeah, that would not be cheap.
That cost us a lot of money, Paul. And
I mean, how is it that you continue to work there?
I need the paycheck. I got a raise in November to 21.5.
To 21.5. Yeah, that's nothing though. That's not. I mean, I'm not. That's it's money. It's good money, but it's not good enough for you to go suffer, and lose your family for.
Well,
not at all.
I know. I'm not done. There's more.
Okay, I'm
There's
sorry.
More.
I don't know how you can take more.
I opened my next gift, and it was a T-shirt, and it was an older T-shirt from the 70s.
Uh-huh.
That had an iron on, had an image ironed onto it. You're familiar with those, correct?
Sure, sure.
And, it was the image of, are you familiar with the singer-songwriter David Crosby?
Oh, yeah, you're from, like, Crosby, Stills, and
right.
And
I mean, I'm not even a fan of this man. I don't even know why they got me this, but it was it was David Crosby's face, head, basically, I guess, from the late 70s when he had a very large mustache.
Uh-huh.
And he's looking into the camera or looking out at you from the shirt with kind of a weird scowl on his face. And the lettering below the picture says, I know I can't say this word on the air, but I'll try to get the message across anyway.
Uh-huh.
Don't F with the Cros.
I don't even know what that means.
That's what I'm not even a fan of David Crosby, but they got me a David Crosby T-shirt that says, don't F with the Cros.
I mean,
what's that about?
I'm in a complete loss of words at that, what that is.
And then I have one gift left.
Uh-huh.
It turns out we had also had a office-wide raffle.
Okay.
That I somehow won.
Mm-hmm.
And the last gift was an envelope with a raffle ticket in it. I had won the raffle.
Uh-huh.
I didn't know what the raffle prize was until I opened up the envelope and pulled it out, and they said, yeah, congratulations, Paul, you've won the raffle.
Mm-hmm.
And what I'd won, well, I mean, what they then began to do, I suppose this is what I had quote-unquote won, is that they caned me in front of the office, the entire office.
Wait, what?
They caned me. They flogged me with a bundle of bamboo stalks in front of the entire office.
Because that was what you won?
That's correct. That was the raffle prize.
How did they do? I mean, how do you let them do that?
Like I said, this is the last time I'm calling you, because I'm finally going to take your advice and I'm going to quit.
You need to. You absolutely need to quit this job now. I mean, this is not even. I mean, how much are you going to let your life just go down the tank?
None anymore. None. It was my New Year's resolution to quit this job.
Okay.
I had a horrible New Year's Eve.
Good. Well, you should do it.
On New Year's Eve, have you ever heard of a pizza chain called Shakey's?
Sure, yeah.
I drove to my neighborhood Shakey's pizza
restaurant, and I smuggled a blanket into the Shakey's, and I wrapped myself in a blanket, and I went to the arcade room behind a video game, and I curled up, and I wept for 8 hours. That's what I did on New Year's
Eve.
That's
how you spent your New Year's... Oh, that's heartbreaking.
In the process, I came up with a New Year's resolution that I was going to quit my job, and I figured that since you've helped me so much, Tom, that I'm going to resign on the air.
You're going to quit your job right now?
I'm going to call the regional manager, which is my boss, a man I never see, by the way.
Okay.
Which is my boss, the regional VP, or manager VP. I know he's my boss.
Uh-huh.
Whatever.
Yeah.
I'm going to call him at home, and I'm going to resign.
I would support that 1,000%.
Do you mind if I do that?
Absolutely not, dude.
Okay, I'm going to use my three-way calling.
Okay,
I'm
good.
I'm going to call him, okay?
Sure.
So stay right there.
I'm not going anywhere. I think you... Oh, it's so heartbreaking. It's like, oh, can you imagine if this was just your life? This guy is... Oh, it never ends either. It's like one...
Tom, are you there?
Uh-huh.
Hello?
Yeah, okay, hello.
Hello, is this Lance McNeil?
Yeah, you got it, dude.
Lance, I'd like you to meet Tom Scharpling. He's also on the phone with us. Oh, by the way, this is Paul Crenshaw.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I remember. I think Peter...
It's Paul.
Peter, yeah. Gotcha.
All right.
Okay.
I'd like you to meet Tom.
Okay,
Tom's the host of a radio show. He's been helping me out a whole lot with my problems at work and home over the past 8 months.
I should say, first of all, you're on the air. You're on the radio.
Right now?
Yes.
Paul, just keeping in with the HR protocol?
Well, I'm not really going to have to worry about that too much anymore, Lance, because I'm calling you to resign from my position as office manager.
Right. Kind of strange there, Chief. I mean, you're there kind of keeping all the little Indians in the tribe in a line down there. You're my chief. And, you know, Q1 here. And, we're trying to start off on a good foot. Well, you're part of the team there, Paul.
You apparently have no idea how I've been treated at the workplace, Lance.
I mean, this guy has been treated horribly.
There may have been a couple of memos, and he may have mentioned something in passing in the hall.
In the hall?
What yeah.
Do you mean in the hall?
There was one time I was there meeting with Peterson,
You've never even stepped foot in our office building since I've become office manager. What is this in the hall?
I'm sorry. Are you resigning because you just took over my boss's job or something? Listen. I know where I've been. Come on. I'm sure we can work it out.
It's gone too far. I've been abused, beaten. Just debased to no end by these people who I'm supposed to be in charge of, and they threaten me with bodily harm if there's even a look in my face like I'm gonna call you or call the police, and I'm scared and I'm sick of being scared and I'm resigning to you tonight. I've had the worst holiday season of my life. My wife and kids, they left me because of this job.
We have the McGivney account still open. That's a big piece of pie we're trying to all eat.
Well, you guys can enjoy it on your own because I can't take this anymore. It was very hard to provide Christmas gifts for my wife and kids when I'm mailing the gifts to my mother-in-law's house, and I don't even know if they're getting there. I don't know what kind of a Christmas my kids have had because they've left me because of this horrifying job.
They had a pretty good Christmas, I bet. I think they probably had a pretty good Christmas.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I mean, I feel pretty confident they raked it in. Don't worry. Don't you worry about that, Saul. I think we got that one covered. I mean, yeah. whatever.
Well, how?
The McGivney account, though, is.
How do you, let me just interrupt. How do you know? I mean.
I think what kids wouldn't enjoy an Xbox and a GameCube for Christmas? I mean.
My kids didn't get that for Christmas because I made a dream catcher.
Is that a video game thing?
No, that's a Native American decoration that hangs from the rearview mirror of a car.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
I made one for Dakota so he could hang it on his bedroom doorknob, but I don't really know if he got it or not.
Yeah, well,
And by the way, what's this? You seem fairly overly confident about my children having a great Christmas and my wife having a good Christmas. I was wondering how you knew this.
Maggie had a pretty good Christmas.
My wife, Margaret?
Yeah, well, I call her Mags, Maggie, you know. Let me break it to you, Paul. Four of us went up to my folks have a place, cabin up in Snowmass, and we went up there for the holidays, and I got Dakota and Carlson, I got them Xbox, GameCube, and I bought your wife, got her a little PT Cruiser, canary yellow, and a personalized license plate. You know what it says?
What?
Fresh start.
That's too many letters.
Well, maybe for you it is. I made a couple of calls at DMV. But anyway, they had a very fine Christmas.
Hey, can I get another Amstel Light, honey?
Thank you, darling.
That's Margaret in the background.
So wait, you're with this guy?
You know, it's a small world, isn't it? Isn't that a Christmas song?
That's horrible.
Well, you know, anyway. Hey, but we're on the same team.
I'm not on that team anymore.
I think you're talking crazy. You have some leftover eggnog or something there, Paul. Come on. The mamas and papas survived it.
I'm going to resign. And I'm going to do it right now.
Well, I don't know if I'm going to let you resign.
Oh, really?
Well, there's some paperwork, the Cobra plan. What about your, your 401k? It's just, I think you're, they like you down there. I mean, I got some memos that said you had a really good Christmas party down there.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, do you have any idea of the conditions that seem to be going on down there?
Hey, it's just a little hazing in the business world.
I mean, it's pretty illegal, if you ask me, from the sound of a lot of it.
Oh, every office place has the email jokes and the little things that we do to our coworkers just to make the day go a little quicker.
Uh-huh.
So what do you hear from these people? What kind of emails do you get from these people?
Nothing. I've got a couple people in the office there giving me reports. I'm sorry if you don't feel like you had a good Secret Santa time.
No, I don't feel like I had a good Secret Santa.
Well, I'm sorry.
I don't feel like that.
But, it's a little late. A little late to be coming. I mean, we got a lot of projects in the pipe.
Do you know, they don't even... I don't even know what my name around there is anymore. I mean, they...
Well, moderator, may I speak to the moderator, please?
Tom, I think he wants to...
Yeah,
the moderator,
I'm,
yes.
I'm a host
I'm just trying
of a,
to follow the protocol.
Yeah, I'm a host of a program. I'm not moderating something.
For these purposes, if you would, sir, do you know what they call Paul, down there?
Where?
At the office. It kind of came to me in a little memo. But,
What do they call him?
They call him Tall Paul, the dim-witted giant. Yeah.
Why, well,
do you know that, moderator?
No, I didn't. Again, I'm not a moderator. I'm the host of a program, and
okay.
you kind of can't talk to me the way you talk to to Paul. Why are they calling him Tall Paul?
I don't. Why don't you? You know, I don't know.
Well, is that? I mean, have you been called? Is that something
have
you're
I
called?
Ever been called the dim-witted giant at work yet? Yes, I mean,
uh-huh.
I have, amongst other things.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, how tall are you?
Well, I'm 6'9".
Uh-huh.
That's tall. That is tall, 6'9". But, you know, well, how big are you? Big?
I weigh 340.
So you're 6'9", 340. Can I just ask you one question, Paul?
Yes.
How come how do you let people push you around if you're that big?
I'm afraid of conflict.
I mean, like, why don't you just, like, when some intern is, like, telling you to get off the phone and hits you with, like, a frozen dinner, why don't you just crush him? I mean, like why don't you just, like, you know, you're big enough to hurt him.
Well, that's not really the, I mean, I don't want to sink down to their level. That's not really how the office place should be, you know, how you should conduct yourself in a corporate environment.
But you need to stick up for yourself as a human. It's not even a matter. They have no respect for you in that office. Why should you have respect for their protocol?
That's right, honey. The other one. That's it. Hey, guys, Sports Center's going to come on in about 5 minutes. So, you know, anyway, so
well,
I got to
no.
I quit. I'm not accepting this.
I resign. I will not be in that office tomorrow. I quit.
All right, well, I'll talk to you. You know, I'm sure you'll forget about it.
But I quit.
See you tomorrow.
I quit. No, I'll mail the office my security badge tomorrow. That's what I'll do. I'll get out of bed, and I'll mail the office my security badge.
Mm-hmm.
That's the only thing I'm doing tomorrow. You won't see me around there.
Uh-huh.
Let them have it. Let those animals tear that place to pieces. I don't care. I quit. And enjoy the show, and enjoy my wife, and enjoy my kids.
I don't know about the last two, but I'm sure I'll take care of that. Don't worry.
Oh.
I can't believe this. I've got to go, Tom. Bye.
Wow, that's a way to start off 2002. Boy, that's... Oh, I'm completely depressed now. Oh... Oh, that's depressing. I am completely now just... Oh, thank God there's only a few minutes left in the show. Remember, again, if you want your Friends of Tom card, just email thomas@wfmu.org. We'll get you your card. Oh. What's going on over there, Dave?
Oh, just a couple of hang-ups.
Come on, people. Don't hang up on Dave. That's Bush League. I also want to thank Dave for coming down and co-producing the program. And I want to thank Paul Collins for coming on and talking about his book, Banvard's Folly. And... Oh, I'm completely... I'm going to just play a record. Goodbye. We'll be right back.
All right, you're listening to WFMU East Orange, WXHD Mount Hope, worldwide on the World Wide Web at WFMU.org. Stay tuned for Nickel and Dime Radio with your host, Small Change.